Welcome to Shihlobo, and thank you for tuning in. Today, Bishop Mr. Sono talks about God's making process. God is a potter, His intentions and mission for your life. God wants to turn you into what you were not before. So sit back and enjoy the sermon.
I've simply entitled the theme for this month, God's making process. When we encounter God in our lives, God begins a process of making us. Depending on how much we are willing to follow Him and to cooperate with Him, we can then experience a process of transformation such that our latter lives bear no resemblance to our former lives. When God comes into our lives and when we encounter Him, God immediately starts that process. In Matthew 4:19, Jesus meets two brothers, Simon Peter and his brother Andrew. Listen what He says to them in Matthew 4:19. And He said unto them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Follow me, follow me. If you follow me, I will make you, Jesus said. If you follow Him, He will make you. If you follow Him, He's going to do something. In other words, you're not called to be a stagnant Christian. Some people don't grow. They don't change. They're still the same people. They've encountered Christ, but nothing about them is changing. What God wants is to change. He says, "Follow me and I will make you." In the New English Translation, it reads, Jesus said, "Follow me, I will turn you into fishers of men." God wants to turn you in what you were not before. God wants to turn you for the better. God wants to find you as a person who doesn't walk in faith and turn you so that you become a man and woman filled with faith. God wants to find you as somebody who has no vision, has no direction whatsoever, and God wants to turn you and give you vision and give you direction. Like I said, so that your latter self bears no resemblance to your former self. That when people meet you years later, they can't believe it's you. In fact, you can't believe it's you. You almost want to pinch yourself and say, "Is this me?" And as I've looked at our lives, many of us, my life, I look back and I realize, my goodness, I've changed so much. See, God wants us to change, but for the better, not for the worst. God wants us to get better. God wants us to move from glory to glory, from faith to faith. That verse in the Message Bible, this is how it reads. It says, Jesus said to them, "Come with me, I'll make a new kind of fisherman out of you." God wants to make a new kind of person out of you. I'm just saying there's somebody who is hidden inside of you that you have not discovered yet. God wants to unearth you. God wants to bring you out just like an artist. When they just get a piece of wood or a log and they put that piece of wood there, when you look at it, it's just a worthless piece of wood. It's just a log, just something that is just worthless and has no value at all. But a good artist knows how to spend time carving, cutting, shaping, forming. After a while, something comes out of this thing that had no form and had no shape. And whatever comes out starts becoming something of value so that what has come out can be sold for a lot of money. Some of you, you don't know, you are a person. There's a person of value hidden on the inside of you. And God wants to carve you and shape you and mold you and bring out the great person. Some of you, you haven't met the greater you. You are still living as the ordinary you. But I'm telling you, this month, God is going to bring out the greater you. Some of you are not even saying amen even now. That's why you are not changing. Yeah. But when we follow God, He takes us through the journey of making us. And the Bible says when Jesus spoke to Peter and Andrew, it says immediately they dropped their nets and followed Jesus. And then the making process started. Who thought this fisherman called Peter, who was filled with fear, who was racist at heart against Gentiles, this man who would always be too quick with his mouth and would never follow up on his promises, whoever thought this man one day would stand against the people that he was afraid of and not be afraid to lay down his life and not give up this time and face his own countrymen and say whether it is right for you to preach in the name of Jesus or not, you make up your mind. But as for me, I will obey God rather than man. Who thought that this is the same man who could raise a man at the gate of Beautiful and say, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. Who thought, Bible history tells us that Peter was the man who was crucified for his Lord upside down. But there was a time when he denied his Lord. But now he is standing for his Lord and suffers for his Lord and is crucified for his Lord. Some of you who are the giving up type, there's a strong somebody on the inside of you who is not the giving up type. And God wants to shape you and bring that person out of you. Can I hear an amen? Can I hear an amen? Amen? Just bump your neighbor and say, there's a new person coming out of me. God uses these metaphors and analogies of making people. Even when he talks, he uses the language. In Genesis 12:2, he says to Abraham, I will make you a great nation. Greatness is a process of being made. You become great. You are made to be great. He says, I'll make you a great nation. He says, I will bless you and I will make your name great. In other words, I'll give you fame. I'll give you prestige. I'll make you prosper. Then he says, and thou shalt be a blessing. In Ephesians 2:10, he uses another analogy there. And I like the language, the way it's crafted. Paul says, we are God's workmanship. Wow. We are God's workmanship, utwaring, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. There are good works. Somebody say good works. Look at your neighbor and try and smile, even if you're not smiling. Say good works, neighbor. What are these good works? You see, these good works are not the ones that take us to heaven. All right. These are the good works that we do after we are God's children, after we know we're going to heaven. So these ones don't take us to heaven. We go to heaven through the grace of God by receiving Christ. But after you are born again, God expects you to do good works. Somebody say good works. Look at your neighbor and say good works. What are those good works? This is your assignment, the reason why you came into the world. These are things that God has crafted for you and has ordained for you to walk in them. In other words, these are assignments that have your name on them. Amen. Things that God says, Mantwesi, the reason she's going to come into the world is to come and do such and such. And that's why Mantwesi art. Oh, thank Mantwesi in the house. Or Mafanela. That's why Mafanela art. Or Mandle Nkosi. That's why Mandle Nkosi art. Or Mufirifiri. That's why Mufirifiri art. Whoever you are, God is saying, this is for them. This job is for them. And so when you come into the world, God starts the process as a workman to work you. That word workmanship is a very interesting word. In the Greek, it's spelled P-O-I-E-M-A, if you want to write it down. P-O-I-E-M-A, pronounced poema. Yes, by it's 7 o'clock. Poema. And that word poema means a product. You are God's product. That word means fabric. You are God's fabric. Just like a good tailor taking good fabric and cutting it according to pattern to fit a specific person and to custom make it for a specific person so that even when they wear that garment, there's no need by donsa by yeteng by pata by yeteng. You have an assignment, and God is cutting you and shaping you and designing you for a particular assignment. And the world is a poorer place when you don't fulfill that assignment. Maraire, God is going to make you as a workmanship. In other words, he starts shaping you and making you and molding you. God starts a process of making you. So the more you cooperate, the better for the world. Because the sooner you get to be what God wants you to be, the sooner you can fulfill your assignment. And the more God makes you is the more completely you can do your assignment. You see, assignment, there's a place where your character prevents you from being everything that God wants you to be. There are people who start churches, but they cannot cross a certain line. They just start with a church, and 5 years later, they get into some immorality. So you see, if they had allowed God to take out this immorality stuff out of them, they would have gone on to have a church for 10 years, not just one church, two churches, three churches. Oh, am I talking to people who are quiet in this place? Some of you, God gives you one tender, musebetsi oyi-one, how bona tjhelete, you fall apart. You start spending it on everything, living beyond your means, because you have not been made and shaped in that area of frugality. You don't know what it is to be a good steward. You don't know what it is to spend well. So God wants to shape that part of you so that when he starts giving you tenders, you don't go berserk in your head. Look at somebody and say, I feel this prophecy is for you. Shaba yaba. So we are God's workmanship. God wants to shape us. God wants to make us. The Amplified Bible reads as follows. Iri, we are God's own handiwork. His workmanship. Recreated in Christ Jesus, born anew, that we may do those good works which God predestined and planned beforehand for us, taking paths which he prepared ahead of time that we should walk in them, living the good life which he prearranged and made ready for us to live. God has prearranged a good life for you, a life of anointing, a life of prosperity, a life of success, a life of power. Yeah. God has a destiny for you. But you see, the fulfillment of that destiny is predicated upon you cooperating with God's making process. See, because if God can make you, you can't pass certain stages. Are you here, Bazalan? And so God uses these metaphors. But I think the metaphor used or the analogy used in Jeremiah 18, which is what I want to talk about for the remainder of the time I have, is one of the most powerful. In Jeremiah 18, verse 1, the word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, arise and go down to the potter's house. He says, and there I will cause you to hear my words. Now, you remember last week what Pastor Dick said? He said, you know, the Bible uses a lot of metaphors. Picture language. So God says to Jeremiah, Jeremiah, I've got a spiritual truth I want you to get. But to get it, I want you to go down to the potter's house, to that guy who works with clay, who makes all kinds of vessels. Go there and watch. Just watching natural things, you will learn a lot about spiritual things. Okay, you can go to the next verse. Hey. He says, then I went out to the potter's house, and behold, he worked a work on the wheels. Verse 4. And the vessel was that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. Note that. And he made it again, another vessel. And it seemed good to the potter to make it as the cell phone is switched off. Bless you, Jesus. Now, let's go over this a bit. These verses, you know, there's two things in the verse. He says, I went there, I looked what the potter was doing. He had a wheel, and he was making it as it pleases. And that's all he says. But, you know, he's not telling us the entire story. So, now that God has used the metaphor of the potter and the clay, let's look at what happens when these people who are called potters, whom make these beautiful vessels in olden days out of clay. We still have things made out of clay today, but most of them are made out of porcelain. But what is the process? And God is specific to use something that was happening in those days. And he says, when you go there and look at the process, that's how I get involved in making people. Oh, yeah.
Are you there, bazalana ne?
Are you ready?
Yes. I'm not convinced. Are you ready?
Yes.
I said, are you ready?
Yes.
All right, let's see what happens. The first thing God uses these images to describe all that. So the first thing we find is the potter and his mission. In other words, this person who's making these vessels, these pots, this potter has a mission. In other words, this potter has an intention about the pots. God has an intention about your life. God says, I know the thoughts that I think towards you. Thoughts to give you peace, to do you good, to give you a future and a what? And an expected end. God wants to give you a future. That's God's intention. God's intention towards you is not a bad one. Some of you, you need to say that to yourself next time you are tempted to believe that God is your enemy. You know, there are so many people who believe God is their enemy. Anything bad that happens, I guess even with the move to hang. Tell your neighbor, with the next. God has good intentions about you. God thinks good thoughts about you. In fact, Barcelona, God so desires for your life to be better even more than you desire. So it's the potter and their intentions. The potter has a singular purpose. He plans to take clay, and from that clay, he wants to produce a vessel. That's the intention. The potter wants to make a vessel that will reap a profit. He wants to make a vessel that will be useful. He wants to make a vessel that will bring honor unto him. That's what God wants. He wants to take your life, your broken life, my broken life, and add value to it. Take it up, not take it down. You know, Runa, when we were growing up in Christianity, people gave us the impression as though when they came to God, they lost something. You know that you know, people are talking like it was an unfair exchange. Almost like, you know, I was having all this fun and creating. The truth is, Basalana, God wants to take clay, worthless, useless clay. Clay that has no value. Clay that nobody wants. And God wants to take this clay. And if this clay will allow God to work on it, he'll give it honor, he'll give it glory, he'll give it prestige. It will be expensive. I'm telling you. I've seen it. When we walk with God, that's what God does. Years later, when you see us, you think this is the way we were born. This is not the way we were born. Somebody out there transforms our life. Can I hear an amen in the house? He wants to take this useless clay. You see, God excels in taking old, worthless clay and transforming it by his grace into vessels of honor and glory. So if you're here today and you feel like you're old and worthless, you feel like you're not where you ought to be, I want to tell you, God hasn't given up on you. I want to tell you, God will never give up on you. I want to tell you, God will never look away from you. I want to tell you, God is not going to focus on the good ones and forget the bad ones. Jesus says, when the doctor comes, the doctor doesn't come for those who are well. He says, when the physician comes, he comes for those who are sick. When the doctor comes, he comes for those who are not well. If you are sick, if you are not well, that's why Jesus came. He came for you. If you are sitting in this place and sitting in this house and you have done some bad things and you have done some wrong things, you've come to the right place, because this is the place where Jesus changes people. This is the place where God transforms people. He takes useless people, worthless people. He takes people that nobody wants to have anything to do with you. God says, if they reject you, if they say you are a no-name brand, mina, I claim you, ungowam, I love you, and I want to do something in your life. The potter takes the clay, which is worthless. And Paul understood this in 1 Corinthians 4:13. In the NIV, he says, we are the scum of the earth, the refuse of the world. See, Jesus saves the sinner by his grace, and then he begins the process of changing this vile sinner into a vessel that will produce a profit for the kingdom of God. What grace is there? Musawa Mudimu, to take somebody on a ruhakana and change them and transform them and use the same mouth to preach the holy word of God. God takes hands that used to steal, hands that used to kill, and use those same hands and lay them on the sick, and the sick get healed. Can I hear an amen? God takes somebody whose life was going the wrong direction, killing people, and he uses that life to go in the right direction, saving people by the grace of God. That's the kind of God he is. And God takes us and makes us useful for his work. And he brings honor and glory to his name. God is interested in taking the worst he can find and changing them into the best that heaven has to offer. That's why we're here. Yeah, that's why we're here. Yeah, we're in God's factory. What a kanda mudim. Yeah, it's not every sermon, every ratang, understand rakandi wa his. Yeah, we understand God is making us. We are not there yet, but we know that God is making us. How many of you can say, God is making me here? Number two, in order to accomplish this lofty goal of making this beautiful pot, the potter must work with materials that leave much to be desired. First of all, when he finds the clay, it's in a bad condition. Usually the clay is found at the riverbed or somewhere. It's found in the ground, and when it's found, it's not even suitable for use. It is just worthless. When he finds this clay, it's full of stones and sticks and mixed with a lot of grime, honalidi tissue, honalidi matapa, mabotlolo, everything. Paul says, actually, in 1 Timothy 1:15, this is a faithful saying, and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Paul says, you want to talk about worthless people? I am worthless number one. I am sinner number one. Yeah, number one. And so the clay is dug out from the ground, sometimes from the riverbed, and brought to the vicinity of the pottery, you see, because we've got to take this clay and take it to the potter. If the clay doesn't go back to the potter's hands, it cannot be made. Some of you clay out there, you are walking far away from God the potter. You are running away from him, and you are expecting your life to change and be transformed. It can never change. It can never be transformed if you never come into the hands of the potter. So the clay is brought into the vicinity of the potter. And then this dry material is then dumped into cement-lined tanks. This is what the potter does. Takes this dry stuff, dumps it in cement-lined tanks or wooden tanks, dumps them in these troughs, and then covers it with water. That's the first thing. The clay, when it comes in contact with the potter, the first thing the potter does is to make it come in contact with the water. Bible says, we are washed with the washing of the water of the word. Oh. Retamona rebaiza. Relatechile. And when we come in contact with the word. Yeah. And note, the clay is made soft by water. Yeah, see, when God's word comes into your life, and just to soften us and to just make us pliable and makes us to cooperate with God. And the water comes upon our lives. And then when the lumps have been softened, they are stirred in water until all has disintegrated into a thin, slimy mud, which they call a slip, S-L-I-P, until that has been formed. And then when that has been formed, this slip
is drawn off into other tanks to settle. And after it's drawn and it has settled at the bottom of the tank, then the stones are taken out. And the lumps that are remaining behind are taken out. This is when you come to church and there's the water of the word comes. And the water of the Holy Spirit comes and God starts dealing with the lumps and the stones and the bottles and the sticks in your life. Out that day where you can't run away from the sermon. Yeah, instead of being angry, instead of allow the potter to take out those stones and take out those things. Because those are the things that delay the potter in making us into what we need to be. There are things that God must take out of our lives, Bazalwana. Because I can never be what you want me to be. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
And then the clay, once they've taken out all of that, the clay then also settles and the water is drawn off it. And the clay is left in a plastic, looking like a plastic-like material. And then they come and tread it with their feet. Now realize, they haven't formed the vessel yet. Yeah, see, in English, we want to operate at certain levels. We want God to use us at certain levels. And we are wondering, God is not using us. God is still making us. Asika be ready. We still have stones and sticks, and God must still tread us, and they tread this clay. And then finally, this clay is finally packed away. Watch this. And it's allowed to stand for 6 months before it's used. This is where God puts you on the shelf. You think, God, I'm ready. God says, you're not ready. God, I want to do this. God says, hey, chill. Chillax. You are not ready.
Well, that's all the time we have for today. Thank you so much for tuning in. We hope you've been blessed as much as we have. You can keep in touch with us via our social media platforms. Our details for our Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook account are on the screen. You can also call us on 086-11-47-223. And that is 086-11-47-223. And that is for more information on Grace Bible Church and the branch closest to you. Thank you for tuning in. God bless you. Let's meet again next week, same time, same channel.